My name is Lisa O'Brien, and I'm the founder of the Utah COVID-19 Long Haulers Group, a group that I started back in June of 2020 that now has over 3,000 members from Utah and surrounding areas who are dealing with the long-term effects of COVID-19 to some degree. It's a pleasure to be here today to share my patient perspective of long COVID, and in the next slides, we will look at many different aspects of this illness, including what it is, its characteristics, and the challenges many who experience it are facing. Dr. Lucinda Bateman will follow my presentation and address post-viral syndromes, common comorbid conditions, and how healthcare professionals can approach the evaluation and management of long COVID patients. My experience with long COVID began over 550 days ago, on March 11th, 2020, the same week that the country began to shut down. There were no cautionary measures in place yet, and I had just returned home from a trip to Hawaii. I share the two photos on the left to show that I am young, and like lots of long haulers, prior to COVID, I was generally healthy with no known underlying conditions and lived a fairly active lifestyle. My first symptoms initially did not match the three they were using to screen people that would provide me with access to a test. 2 weeks after symptoms started, I finally got tested and it came back negative. My acute phase was mild and I never required hospitalization, but symptoms never went away entirely, and over time they started to change. In month two, I began having heart flutters, and around this time I found the first long hauler support group. There were 300 of us at the time having really bizarre symptoms following a virus we had just been infected with. Nobody had answers or knew where to turn. Month three through 10 were the worst, and I cycled through over 50 different symptoms. Every day was different, and I could never predict what symptoms would show up from hour to hour or day to day. I spent most of my time in bed. I started having to use a shower chair to shower, use a wheelchair to get around at my doctor appointments, and have my kids drive me to all my appointments because I didn't trust my body to behave the way it was supposed to. Here are just a handful of the symptoms that I experienced from day to day. Brain fog, dizziness, internal tremors, burning and tingling in my hands and feet, erratic heart rates that would spike to 160 beats per minute just from standing up, but sometimes they would fall to 30 beats per minute. Adrenaline rushes, insomnia, short-term memory loss, hair loss, blurry vision, and they found a pulmonary embolism at the end of month three. I went to 2 to 3 doctor appointments a week for the first 10 months, trying to find someone here in Utah who would take me seriously or not brush off my symptoms for anxiety. In month four, I was onboarded into a recovery program through Mount Sinai in New York, and it was the very first time that I felt heard and hopeful. They were seeing thousands like me out there, and I received my first clinical diagnosis. They believed I had had COVID. In month 11, I was accepted into the long COVID program at the Bateman Horn Center, where I finally received a diagnosis of postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, mast cell activation syndrome, orthostatic intolerance, and I was told that my symptoms aligned with the hallmark symptoms of myalgic encephalomyelitis, commonly referred to as chronic fatigue syndrome. It has been a really slow recovery, but my doctors and I are optimistic that I will one day be able to fully live the life I once did. But the future of each long hauler looks different. What is long COVID? The CDC says that although most people with COVID-19 get better within weeks of illness, some people experience post-COVID conditions. These conditions are a wide range of new, returning, or ongoing health problems that people can experience 4 or more weeks after first being infected with the virus that causes COVID-19. Even people who did not have COVID-19 symptoms in the days or weeks after they were infected can have these post-COVID conditions. These conditions can present as different types and combinations of health problems for different lengths of time. What this looks like varies from person to person, and some of the symptoms that the CDC has listed on their website are on this slide. But this is only a fraction of the symptoms that patients have reported in other large studies. Long COVID is the patient-preferred name for this illness, but it can also be referred to as post-COVID condition, long-haul COVID, long-term effects of COVID, chronic COVID, or PASC, post-acute sequelae of SARS-CoV-2. a patient-led study that was conducted by a group called the Patient-Led Research Collaborative was released in July of 21, and it showed the prevalence of over 200 symptoms in 10 different organ systems reported by the over 3,000 participants. Participants experienced an average of 55 or more symptoms across an average of 9.1 organ systems. This slide shows the top remaining symptoms still prevalent in their study participants at 6 months into their recovery. The most frequent symptoms reported after month six were fatigue, post-exertional malaise, and cognitive dysfunction. Some things that you should know about long COVID. Everyone's recovery is unique. Some patients are dealing with autonomic dysfunction. Some continue to struggle to breathe. Some have cognitive and memory problems. And some are dealing with continued loss of or distorted taste and smell. You can have one of these symptoms or a bunch of them occurring simultaneously. Symptoms continuously change and they can come and go. This is something that frequently happens. And when the symptoms disappear altogether for a period of time, it can make patients believe that they might have finally turned a corner, only to have symptoms pop back up hours, days, or even weeks later. 86% of the participants in the patient-led research collaborative study experienced relapses that were primarily triggered by exercise, physical or mental activity, and stress. They were also triggered by a woman's menstrual cycle. Cognitive dysfunction or memory issues were common across all age groups in the patient-led research collaborative study. 86% of the respondents reported experiencing brain fog and cognitive dysfunction. 72% experienced memory impairments, including both short-term and long-term memory loss. I wanted to go ahead and read a few quotes with you from members of our Utah long hauler group about how the cognitive dysfunction has affected them in their lives. I was driving home from work and lost track of where I was. I couldn't remember what exit I needed to take to get home. I had to call my spouse and have him guide me home by phone. I have lived in my home for 21 years. My husband found my reading glasses in our dishwasher. I have lived in my same neighborhood my whole life, and sometimes when I'm driving, I don't recognize where I am. I have missed turns numerous times and have to pull over to get my bearings. I ordered food from DoorDash and they called to say no one was answering the door. I must have given the wrong address, but then I couldn't remember my actual address to give them. I ended up going outside to look at the number on my mailbox. There have been occasions where I'm looking at my 7-year-old daughter and I can't remember her name. The research on long COVID's prevalence is ongoing, and studies report anywhere from 10 to 35% of COVID patients will end up with the long-term symptoms. But as you can see, in many studies, it's ending up at the higher end of that range. In July of 2020, the CDC presented the first study that attempted to quantify the prevalence of long COVID. They found 1 in 3 were dealing with lingering symptoms beyond the initial 14 days that it was believed it would take to recover completely. Interestingly, the CDC just published a study that was recently done with participants residing in Long Beach who had tested positive for COVID. And it showed that 2 or more months later, 1 in 3 were still having health problems. So what does that look like? Well, the American Academy of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation recently developed a dashboard that assumes 30% of people who recover from acute COVID will develop long COVID. With this assumption, the dashboard estimates that 11.1 million Americans could be dealing with long COVID. They broke these estimates down into individual state counts, and the model estimates 100,000 potential COVID long haulers here in Utah. The data on this slide also comes from the study conducted by the patient-led research collaborative team. COVID seems to be predominantly affecting women at 80% of their 3,000 participants. 91% of long haulers had mild cases with no hospitalizations, and only 35% visited an ER or urgent care. And long haulers are fairly young. 55% are anywhere from 30 to 49. This slide shows some of the more common post-COVID syndromes that we are seeing patients start to get diagnosed with in the long COVID patient groups. postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, which is a form of dysautonomia or a dysfunction of the autonomic nervous system, mast cell activation syndrome, and we're seeing many parallels between long COVID and myalgic encephalomyelitis, which is chronically referred to as chronic fatigue syndrome. We're also seeing a lot of small fiber neuropathy, orthostatic intolerance, fibromyalgia, and other autoimmune diagnoses too. Sadly, most of these syndromes are under-recognized and under-researched, and that has created a challenge for many patients when trying to obtain a proper diagnosis. These are some of the challenges that COVID long haulers are facing. Physically, these symptoms are debilitating and people are no longer able to live life like they used to. Lack of education and awareness has led to patients being dismissed by their providers or receiving little to no support from family, friends, and employers. Some have been disqualified from post-COVID care clinics because they never received a positive test to prove they had COVID. This is especially challenging for those of us who got COVID early on when testing was limited and inaccessible. Some live in geographic locations where they don't have access to these types of clinics. And once these clinics open, the wait list is long. The University of Utah had 300 on their wait list a couple weeks ago and was scheduling into December. People are suffering job loss. 45% of the participants in the patient-led research study required a reduced work schedule, and 1 in 5, or 22%, had been unable to return to work. With job loss, people are losing insurance, and even if you do have insurance, some post-COVID clinics are only covered by certain insurances. So if you want specialized care, you're having to pay high costs out of pocket. The disability process is long, frustrating, and confusing. Some long haulers of certain racial and ethnic groups are experiencing disparities in treatment. Many vulnerable communities lack access to quality care or face heightened burdens to convince providers that their conditions are real. And I'd be lying if I told you that mental health was not a piece of the puzzle. It definitely is. For most, it's the ongoing or debilitating symptoms that are causing the depression or anxiety, and not the other way around. Many of those symptoms appearing in long COVID can look very similar to anxiety. And so it's important to make sure that a patient-centered approach is being taken. Really listen to what your patient is describing. Educate yourself as much as possible on these common comorbid conditions. There's more than enough evidence out there showing that these conditions are persisting in those with long COVID. This slide shows some of the long COVID resources available to patients and caregivers. University of Utah is a hybrid multidisciplinary clinic where one of their providers will evaluate the symptoms related to long COVID and then refer patients to the appropriate specialists that are listed for treatment. The Bateman Horn Center has been seeing long COVID patients since February of 21. They are a lean nonprofit that specializes in post-viral syndromes, and due to capacity limitations, have kept their scope narrow and focused on long haulers that did not have significant organ damage from their COVID exposure. They will use what they learn in their assessment and treatment of long COVID to help other long haulers and medical professionals ensure earlier intervention is afforded. The Northern Utah Rehabilitation Center provides an individualized rehabilitation program with different therapies offered. Caring Connections is part of the University of Utah's post-COVID clinic, but you don't have to be a patient of the clinic to attend these sessions. It has been a beacon of hope for many in assuring they are not alone as they work through their mental wellness surrounding their chronic illness journey. Stasis offers a free breathing program for long haulers that is actually being used in Mount Sinai's post-COVID program. And they report that they are seeing great progress in their patients. The Pulmonary Wellness Foundation offers a free and gentle COVID long haulers boot camp created by pulmonary specialist Noah Greenspan, who has been a phenomenal support of long haulers since June of 2020. And Incel DX offers a program based off of pathologist Dr. Bruce Patterson's long COVID research that he and his team have been conducting since last June to uncover the immunologic causes of long COVID. This slide shows some of the things being done to help support us. Several months ago, the president announced that long COVID could now be counted as a disability under the Americans with Disabilities Act. To qualify, one or more major life activities must be substantially limited. The Recover Initiative is a National Institute of Health program. The NIH awarded nearly $470 million to build a nationwide study population with tens of thousands of long COVID patients, which will support research on the long-term effects of COVID-19. And then the COVID Long Haulers Act. This act will fund research. It will work to improve care for those communities with traditional health disparities and inequities, and will provide education for our healthcare professionals regarding long COVID. That is the end of my presentation. If you or anybody you know has any questions or needs any assistance, I can be reached at utahlonghaulers@gmail.com. I will now turn the time over to Dr. Lucinda Bateman.
I am Dr. Lucinda Bateman, the director of the Bateman Horn Center. It's a pleasure to meet here with you today to talk about our experience with COVID long haulers and the connection to an illness you may not be familiar with, MECFS, or myalgic encephalomyelitis chronic fatigue syndrome. There are also a number of terms applied to the prolonged effects after COVID-19, post-COVID, long COVID, long haul COVID, and the term the NIH initially used, post-acute sequela of COVID-19, or PASC. And I also wanted to write MECFS up here to familiarize you with the term myalgic encephalomyelitis chronic fatigue syndrome. For the purposes of this talk, we'll use the term long COVID. The Bateman Horn Center is a nonprofit interdisciplinary center of excellence where clinical care, research, and education meet to advance the diagnosis and treatment of myalgic encephalomyelitis chronic fatigue syndrome, but also fibromyalgia, other post-viral syndromes, and related conditions like small fiber neuropathy, mast cell activation syndrome, hypermobile Ehlers-Danlos syndromes, and postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome.
So we know that post-viral fatigue has been recognized for decades. And there are many examples, a few here on this slide, of viral infections that we know are associated with chronic lingering symptoms. I will talk about herpes family viruses in the next slide. We know from studies that human parvovirus B19 infection can lead to post-viral syndromes, West Nile virus and other viruses in that family, but also the coronaviruses. And there are some good studies that show that SARS-CoV-1, an outbreak in 2003, primarily in Toronto, led to 9% of people dying, but mortality approached 50% in high-risk groups. But there was a group of patients studied that continued to have symptoms for many years. The MERS, or Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, was a relatively small outbreak in 2012 to 2014. 35% of those infected died. And there have been 2,500 lab confirmed cases and 886 deaths. That caused a very severe post-viral syndrome. And now we have SARS-CoV-2. Herpes family viruses we're mostly familiar with, and that what these viruses have in common in this family is they can all establish latent infection within specific tissues, characteristic for each virus, and they can be reactivated. And while there are 100 known herpes viruses, there are 8 that routinely infect humans. Herpes simplex, varicella zoster, causes chickenpox and shingles, cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, and human herpes virus 6, 7, and 8. Now, what is ME/CFS? It is a chronic debilitating multisystem illness characterized by central and peripheral nervous system disease, immune manifestations, and impaired cellular metabolism. It's thought to be a post-viral syndrome or a post-infection syndrome in most, but not all cases. We know that ME/CFS can be triggered by a variety of pathogens, and the list looks similar to the list I showed you of viruses and pathogens known to cause post-viral syndromes. We know that people with ME/CFS share the same core symptoms, but it is a heterogeneous group, likely due to the different triggers, the systems that are affected, how long the patients have been ill, and what kind of comorbid conditions they develop. But the important thing about ME/CFS is by the time the diagnosis is made, there is generally no definitive evidence left of what the infectious trigger was. So diagnostic criteria have been developed, and while there are quite a few different ones out there, we use the Institute of Medicine ME/CFS clinical diagnostic criteria that are evidence-based criteria published in 2015. They're pretty simple, actually, as long as you know how to apply them. The core criteria required for diagnosis are impaired function associated with fatigue, more than 6 months in duration, the presence of post-exertional malaise or illness relapse from attempting activity, either physical or cognitive, disturbed and unrefreshing sleep, and either cognitive impairment or orthostatic intolerance. But the important thing is these criteria must all be present. They must be moderate to severe and present at least 50% of the time. So they're very prominent and very severe or moderate to severe symptoms. The important thing to know also is there are many, many other symptoms associated with ME/CFS, but they vary across time and in different people, including chronic pain, immune and inflammatory manifestations, manifestations that are like infections, and neuroendocrine symptoms. There are many comorbid conditions that are of interest as we break down the clinical presentation of people who meet ME/CFS criteria. And I've made a list of a few of them here. And the reason it's important is that even though we don't have a primary treatment aiming at the cause of ME/CFS, there are many aspects of illness that are familiar to us in medicine that we can address and go after, including pain amplification, celiac disease, sleep disorders, dysautonomias, et cetera. Some of the things that you heard Lisa talk about that we're starting to see with long COVID. And we know that the acute manifestations of COVID-19, it was and still is an overwhelming pandemic. And we've faced many challenges. The first of which is the focus has been on the severely ill acute COVID-19 patients. And then we shifted to vaccine, and now we're focused on contagious variants. And of course, as Lisa said, many who became ill in 2020 didn't have access to tests, weren't tested or had false negative tests. So we have a large group of people who were sick and are continuing to be sick without objective evidence of the initial trigger. We know that hospitalists have done a great job of learning to deal with acutely ill patients, and our mortality rate is improving. But the problem is in primary care and all outpatient delivery of healthcare, we're struggling now with the aftermath of acute COVID-19. We know that acute COVID-19 is known to cause widespread organ damage across multiple tissues, lung, cardiac, neurologic, gastrointestinal, kidney damage. And this is what creates such severe morbidity in the hospital and lingering symptoms after the acute illness. And many people are still struggling with these organ damage, but also other symptoms. And the common post-COVID-19 sequelae are, again, this list is starting to sound familiar: fatigue, sleepiness, cognitive complaints, pain complaints that go across various modalities of musculoskeletal pain, headaches, pain amplification of fibromyalgia and reactive arthritis, respiratory tract inflammation, both upper and lower respiratory, heart inflammation, that is might be inflammation of the muscle, the sac around the heart. There may be arrhythmias and orthostatic intolerance, and then many, many types of neurologic symptoms. TIA, stroke, dizziness, headaches, confusion, memory problems, neuropathies, in addition to the loss of smell and taste, and also sleep disturbances. And as Lisa related, there is a hypercoagulable aspect to this disease that can cause blood clots, not only acutely, but subacutely down the road, and many other symptoms as well. We like to group I am not always going to call it long COVID, but we'd like to group the post-acute sequelae of COVID into two main groups: those that had a severe infection, were hospitalized, and have lingering organ damage that usually we can identify with labs or diagnostic studies. But there's this other group that's very large, with mild to moderate infection, sometimes even relatively asymptomatic at the time of infection, but they don't recover, or they get increasingly worse in terms of symptoms and impairment. And yet we seem to lack biological markers to identify this group. One of the first studies that came out looking at lingering symptoms after COVID was published in the JAMA network in July of 2020. They looked at 143 patients who at 60 days after hospital discharge. And you can see that on the left were the percent of patients who experienced symptoms during these various symptoms during the acute phase of COVID. But you can see the lingering symptoms 60 days on the right side of the graph that were among this group of 143 patients. This was one of the first studies in the literature suggesting that there were problems with resolution of symptoms. Then there was a study that came out in September of 2020 showing in China, looking at persistent symptoms 90 days after acute COVID. And 54% were female. Again, the median age was middle age. And these patients had numerous symptoms ongoing. And although at that point they reported the symptoms were slowly improving over the 90 days. So how common is long COVID? Well, we really don't know for sure. And the survey that Lisa already talked about, there was this online survey initially of 1,500 people, later grew to even more people that all around the world that filled out questionnaires online, 80% were between 30 and 60 years of age. The majority said that their symptoms had lasted more than 3 months. But the really striking aspect of this was almost half reported that doctors had not listened to or believed them. And this is months into the pandemic, with the focus still on mortality and on the acute manifestations of COVID. And this is, I cut the graph off too a little bit, but this is a graph showing the 50 most common long hauler symptoms from that group. And again, I mainly put that up there to show you how many, and that this is based on the numbers of people who filled out who espoused these symptoms on their questionnaire. And you can see that there are a very large number of symptoms remaining reported by this group. So how common is long COVID? Well, we're working on, there's a lot of discussion about what to call this, because right now we're dating it from 30 days, if you're unwell, for at least 30 days after acute COVID. But there are studies that look at 60 days, 90 days, 3 months, and 6 months. And we've seen many patients in our clinic who've been sick with symptoms for more than 12 months at this point. In fact, we have patients who've been sick since March of 2020 to this current date. We don't know for sure how to divide patients with long COVID, because there may be a way of subsetting based on risk factors and how sick they were acutely, as we discussed, and or we define long COVID by how many symptoms people have. Do we call it long COVID if they have two or three remaining symptoms? And those things have not yet been decided. Do we make a decision about long COVID based on which risk factors and comorbid conditions are present now, or how disabling it is, or why it's a disabling illness? So we have many things to sort out about these persistent symptoms after COVID. And because it hasn't been long enough, we really don't know for sure how quickly people will recover and how many will recover. Although it's been a very long time now for a number of people. We need controlled studies. And I did want to tell you about a very interesting study that was done in the United Kingdom, where early in the pandemic, in March of 2020, they began longitudinal surveillance of more than 2,000 clinical and non-clinical healthcare workers, sampling their blood every month for SARS-CoV-2 antibodies. And approximately 12% developed COVID-19 by lab testing and over a period into November 2020. And the majority of those seroconverted to positive antibodies in March and April of 2020 before they had adequate personal protective equipment. So 8 months after this, an online questionnaire was given to assess 72 current symptoms. And there were 140 who had mild to moderate seropositive cases. So 10.8% of people were seropositive. And none of those cases had been hospitalized, which is kind of a miracle among those healthcare workers. And of those who were positive, 14% had ongoing or episodic symptoms at that 8 month mark. And the rest were asymptomatic. The rest of the large number were people who never were exposed to COVID or developed antibodies. So the there were three clusters of symptoms associated with long COVID in this study. These are very broad clusters, but there were sensory symptoms. So lack of taste and smell, appetite, blurred vision, so multiple sensory modalities. There were neurological or neurocognitive symptoms, forgetfulness, short-term memory loss, confusion and brain fog. And then a big group they lumped in cardiorespiratory, chest tightness, unusual fatigue, breathlessness after minimal exertion, palpitations. And this group probably also contains the large number of people who had dysautonomias. The really interesting thing is in this group of healthcare workers, dermatological, gynecological, gastrointestinal, and mental health symptoms were not significantly different between cases and controls. Now, remember, this is a particularly stressed group of people during the pandemic, working long hours in healthcare, afraid for exposure to COVID, losing sleep, you know, all the stressors that healthcare providers were undergoing. So you can see that just going through the pandemic and being subjected to the severe stress of working in healthcare led to a large number of symptoms that were similar to people who'd been exposed to COVID. There's always the possibility that people were missed in that group also, and we were not able to detect the present their exposure at that time. But here are the mental health symptoms that were equally common in both groups. So the cases, those who became COVID positive were on the left, and the controls, those are the healthcare workers who did not develop antibodies SARS-CoV-2. And these are the ways they answered their symptoms. And you can see that the amount of stress, anxiety, difficulty sleeping, frustration, sadness, trouble waking up in the morning, mood swings, depression, and loneliness were ranked as very high at 8 months after the start of the pandemic in both groups. So what is long COVID? Well, we're learning some things, but the mechanisms are still largely unknown. There are several hypotheses that inflammation may persist for weeks to months after the infection in specific organs. We know to some degree from autopsy that that's true. We think there's a large component of people who have a post-viral immune-mediated disruption of the autonomic nervous system. There have been studies showing that autoreactive T cells and SARS-CoV-2 antibodies may persist after viral, that do persist after the virus is cleared, may cross-react and set up an autoimmune response that could manifest in the central nervous system or as neurological symptoms. And we know that there are long-term neuropsychiatric consequences after viral infections in the literature in previous pandemic, and especially in the 1918 Spanish influenza and the SARS, 2003 SARS epidemic, where patients had a lot of sleep-related fatigue, pain, and encephalitis-type manifestations. I want to present a couple of cases for you to consider. The first is a 70-year-old, very healthy, fit 70-year-old retired, recently retired female who just really her only health issue was high blood pressure and she had recently been started on a statin for mild cholesterol elevation. Early in the pandemic in April, she got COVID, possibly wearing a mask when she was grocery shopping, and had a low-grade fever, massive fatigue, and a rash. And her illness really improved. Most of those symptoms went away in 10 days. But she remained tired. And throughout the summer, she was able to carry out most activities, but anything that required exertion made her feel feverish and exhausted again. So she just took it easy all summer. She had a workup for her symptoms in June, and everything, the echo and chest x-ray and a chest CT labs were all normal. In August, so remember, this is 5 months after her acute COVID, she decided she was going to hire someone to help her recondition. So she hired a personal physical therapist as an exercise trainer to develop a program. And the first week on Monday, she did a light 30 minutes on a recumbent bike. Wednesday, she walked a mile. And Friday, she spent 10 minutes on the elliptical trainer. And after that, in the afternoon, she developed a fever, became exhausted and ill. And from that day on, she was unable to do very much. She could barely do upright activity. She was mostly in bed or a chair. She had impaired exercise tolerance, post-exertional malaise, had to sleep during the day, and it was unrefreshing at night. She developed pain in her limbs and muscles. She was mildly dizzy, and she started becoming more and more anxious about her health. 6 weeks after this, she was still that ill. After those three bouts of exercise, she couldn't get help much. I mean, she had very attentive doctors, but no one knew what to do to help her. Her primary care, she saw a specialist, a neurologic consequences of COVID, and an infectious disease doctor. And the infectious disease doctor told her to exercise more to get through her deconditioning. They had to reduce her blood pressure medicine because her blood pressures got lower and lower. And she had some very mild findings on her labs of a white count, low white count, mild anemia, and she had actually had elevated ferritin, which is an acute phase reactant. So when we saw her, I asked her in a remote visit to do some orthostatic testing at home. And here's what we saw. Her blood pressure and heart rate were normal, lying down 129 over 71 and a heart rate of 74. But you can see that immediately upon standing, her blood pressure tanks and her heart rate goes up significantly. She did it twice. So you can see there are two examples. It happened pretty much the same the both time. And she met criteria for systolic orthostatic hypotension. She also met criteria for POTS, but her primary problem is an orthostatic drop in blood pressure. And this was creating a great deal of difficulty for her and was completely undetected by her very excellent physicians. So this is an example of a dysautonomia that occurred and creating severe orthostatic intolerance. I think this bloomed. I think it may have been present, but that the exercise triggered either a relapse or a worsening of her dysautonomia. So during the summer, just in hindsight, and Lisa mentioned Noah Greenspan. He's a cardiopulmonary physical therapist in New York City who has that boot camp. And early in the pandemic, he started this boot camp to help people who'd been discharged from the hospital. And it was really created for people who were over 70 to help these elderly people recover from their bout with acute COVID. But it soon became apparent to him that people in their 30s, 40s, and 50s were completely exercise intolerant. They had to pare down what they were trying to do in their boot camp to walk for two-minute intervals, increasing 1 minute a day. And these are quotes from him that I think are really important for people in the field of rehab or hospice or home health to understand. He said, we had to come up with a very specialized rehab program and learn fast what's detrimental to them. Little by little, it's like putting together a jigsaw puzzle and disarming a bomb at the same time. We put things together so we could see the entire picture, but we didn't want to cut the wrong wire. He said, you have to meter yourself. We call that pacing in the field of ME/CFS. Then wait a day or two and see how good or bad you feel. You can feel great while you're exercising, but you could be actually hurting yourself. So just a couple of tools to set up the next case. We ask people about upright activity tolerance, and we ask very specifically about the number of hours they spend with feet on the floor in 24 hours and call that hours of upright activity. You've got to ask the question clearly to understand that we're talking about time spent with feet on the floor, which includes sitting with your feet on the floor. And from experience in our clinic, normal healthy people have 14 to 17 hours of upright activity in a 24-hour period. And those with chronic illness tend to sit a lot and spend more sedentary time. So their hours of upright activity are usually 10 to 12. But we have noticed in our clinic that people with ME/CFS often have less than 1 hour of upright activity tolerance, ranging up to 7 or 8 hours, depending on the severity of their illness. And we ask people about what they can do on good days, what they can do on bad days, and their hours of upright activity, and examples of each. So let's look at another case. This is actually a 45-year-old male teacher. This was 7 months since his acute COVID, someone we saw in our clinic. He complained based on questionnaires that we were using at the time of admitting patients. He had fatigue, impaired function, and post-exertional malaise that are very severe and present at least 75 to 100% of the time. You may get the echo of the ME/CFS criteria because we ask about frequency and severity to understand how the important impact of the symptoms. On good days, which are 2 or 3 per month, he can manage 8 hours of upright activity and gave examples of what he can do. He can walk around, clean the house, but not exercise. But the majority days, he says, are bad days every month, and he can only manage 2 hours of upright activity. And most of that is sitting on the couch, making some food, but he can't stand for long or walk outside. And he gets post-exertional malaise after low physical exertion and poor sleep. He also has unrefreshing sleep, moderate in severity, present at least 50% of the time. He complained of cognitive impairment, which he ranked as severe and present more than half of the time, and orthostatic intolerance, very severe and present 75 to 100% of the time. So you can see this long COVID patient meets criteria for ME/CFS, at least by questionnaire, based on impaired function, fatigue, post-exertional malaise, unrefreshing sleep, and he has both cognitive impairment and orthostatic intolerance, now present more than 6 months, moderate to severe, and present at least 50% of the time. He also has other symptoms, but they're less severe and less frequent. Some shortness of breath, myalgias, nausea, loss of taste and smell, skin rashes, and really infrequent or mild tinnitus, vision problems, and allergies. So we really want to encourage people to measure orthostatic intolerance in a standardized way. So we are strongly suggesting that people use what's called the 10-minute Nasaline test. This is a standardized test that can be done in the office and is equal, at least equal to tilt table testing, with the exception of syncope that occurs more in a delayed way more than 10 minutes after orthostatic stress. So this test is done by having people lie down and rest quietly for 10 to 15 minutes and then get a heart rate and blood pressure. Then have them stand quietly against a wall, leaning so that they can relax and have a little bit of assist to their balance, and checking a heart rate and blood pressure every 1 to 2 minutes for 10 minutes. So our male teacher, age 45, here is the lean test he had in our office. And you can see that his resting heart rate in the first two lines is 65 to 67. By the time he'd been standing 8 minutes, his heart rate had increased to 138 beats per minute. And if you see in the far right, the comments, he got more and more symptoms while he was standing, and at 8 minutes, the test was terminated due to pretty overwhelming symptoms, and we didn't want to continue the test till he actually passed out. His heart rate went up 65 beats per minute. From 65 beats per minute to 138, which is an increase of 73 beats per minute simply from standing in place. So this meets criteria for postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, or POTS, which only requires an increased heart rate of 30 beats per minute for adults and 40 beats per minute in the younger age group under age 18. And is cognitive impairment present? How does orthostatic intolerance impact cognition? Well, as part of our intake in the clinic, we do a handheld 5-minute cognitive battery that's made of 3 parts to assess the change in cognition from orthostatic stress. And the slowed reaction time, the first one, simple reaction time. Well, they're all reaction times, but I'm going to show you in the next slide the simple reaction time. And slowed reaction time is one of the most sensitive measures of impaired cognitive functioning. And if you'll focus really just on the simple reaction time, and this is a cognitive efficiency score. So high scores are better and low scores are worse. And the first column is ME/CFS. The second column is our long COVID patients. And the third column is our healthy controls from a study we're doing. And the lines, if you look at ME/CFS, the first point is before the lean test, and the second point is immediately after the lean test. You can see that the simple reaction time, the efficiency score, goes down simply from an orthostatic stress. You can see on the far right, the healthy controls, their cognitive efficiency actually stays the same or goes up after the lean test. And our long COVID patients started at a very low baseline and dropped even further before and after the lean test. So orthostatic stress in their case was equally damaging. And we think it's possible that their initial pre-lean test scores are lower in part because they did the test an hour or two after they'd been interviewed. Not all patients had an interview before their lean test, but it's very ominous, these low cognitive, the simple reaction time, cognitive efficiency scores in our long COVID group, either before, but especially after at an orthostatic stress. So there are important conditions to consider in long COVID patients beyond obvious organ damage, and Lisa went over them, but it won't hurt to talk about, to review them one more time. Cognitive impairment. Cognitive impairment may be one of the biggest reasons people can't remain in the workforce or back to their ordinary activities. It's mainly cognitive slowing that makes it very difficult to multitask and to work in a competitive situation. Postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, orthostatic hypotension, or other forms of dysautonomia, and you really have to do good standardized orthostatic testing to accurately pick this up. It is really not adequate to do a 3-minute orthostatic test, and you must start from a true baseline supine and compare that to at least 10 minutes in the standing position. These patients can have small fiber neuropathies. They can develop mast cell activation, which is really a very ramped up allergic response system by jumpy mast cells that react in multiple systems. We've seen patients develop new sleep apnea syndromes, as well as many types of sleep disturbances. They're getting GI dysfunction, which we all know how to address and really can do a workup. But most important, there are a group of people with long COVID that go on to meet all the criteria of ME/CFS. I showed you common comorbid conditions in ME/CFS. Well, this is the same slide, but I've used yellow whiteout to show the common comorbid conditions that have been seen and published. The publications have been out there about these comorbid conditions in patients with post-acute sequelae of COVID or long COVID. So pain amplification, central sensitivity, small fiber and peripheral neuropathies, dysmotility of the upper and lower gastrointestinal tract and small intestine bacterial overgrowth, sleep disorders, dysautonomias, the MCAS, as we've discussed, and viral reactivation. There have been studies showing that during acute COVID, there are many viruses that reactivate and may have sort of a co-infection or really work together to confound or complicate the sequela of acute COVID infection. So COVID-19 can teach us many things about post-infectious syndromes and ME/CFS. As I hope I've convinced you, the causes of post-infectious fatigue syndromes and ME/CFS have many similarities. And it is very possible that longitudinal studies of people who develop long COVID can help reveal the causes of these illnesses. And we really must do careful longitudinal studies of long COVID so that we'll assess the presence and severity of symptoms and compare long COVID to the things we already know about ME/CFS and post-viral syndromes. We must look at objective markers at the early stages of illness, at the immune system, metabolism, gene structure, gene expression, and of course, the nervous system, and especially tests of cognition, sleep, functioning of the brain and nervous system, and the heart and cardiovascular system. Lisa also mentioned this on September 15th. There was a news release announcing that the National Institutes of Health have awarded $470 million for what is called a RECOVER initiative to more than 100 researchers at 30 institutions who will all work together to learn why people with prolonged symptoms or new symptoms develop after infection with COVID-2. And the most common symptoms of pain, headaches, fatigue, brain fog, shortness of breath, anxiety, depression, fever, chronic cough, and sleep problems are recognized in this initiative. And there will be common data sharing and same techniques used, and all of the studies of this initiative will be pooled to try to understand the evolution of long COVID or prolonged symptoms over time. There has been interim guidance from the CDC, and I think what's really important to point out about the interim guidance, which you can read for yourself if you want to go look at it, is recognition that long COVID is an entity, that it can be managed by physicians, and especially in bullet number 3, that the lack of laboratory or imaging abnormalities does not invalidate the existence, severity, or importance of a patient's symptoms or conditions. That healthcare providers should set achievable goals, work with their patients, and it's okay to approach treatment by focusing on specific symptoms and conditions, meaning comorbid conditions. You do not have to have objective tests or have a single treatment to treat the whole disorder. There are many things that can be addressed at all aspects and all levels of healthcare delivery. Understanding post-COVID conditions is really incomplete, and guidance will continue to come over time as the evidence evolves. So I just wanted to emphasize and share a time-tested treatment approach that we use at Bateman Horn Center when patients come in to be evaluated for complex multi-system illness. First is to identify and treat all medical conditions that are present, whether comorbid or underlying risk factors, previous risk factors. Everything that can be identified should be fine-tuned and treated fully to reduce the comorbid symptoms that might be complicating the picture. Then it is critical that patients learn to pace activity to prevent and reduce the severity and duration of post-exertional malaise. This is a key intervention for ME/CFS, and we're seeing that this is a very key intervention for long COVID. You cannot force a return to physical activity, pushing through illness symptoms without the risk of dramatically worsening illness and worsening function and putting the patient in a position of setback. It has to be individualized. Then we address the major symptomatic aspects of illness, whatever they may be for that patient, whether it's orthostatic intolerance, whether it's pain, sleep disruption, whether they have secondary mental health issues. And some patients have pre-existing mental health issues that need to be, that you need to continue to address. And then emphasis on, yes, we want people to improve their overall physical conditioning as compatible with illness manifestation, that pacing trumps attempts to develop fitness.
Before we end, I'd like to give you a few links that might be of interest. Way back in January, the NIH director wrote a blog about citizen scientists. And those are the people who have long COVID, who wrote an article about their symptoms and really prompted the medical community to pay better attention. Dr. Francis Collins, the director of the NIH, also wrote another blog on April 20th, and you might enjoy reading those. There was also an NIH workshop on post-acute COVID-19, and this can be found at the link that you see here. Regarding other references in our talk, I've put a few links that might be useful to you. One is a link about resources about mast cell activation. Another is the link that can help you understand dysautonomias and POTS. And then, of course, we have a lot of great educational resources on the Bateman Horn Center YouTube site and also on our website. We have patient resources, but we have a lot of provider resources regarding these illnesses. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk to you today, and I'm very happy to be of assistance in any way that I can in the future.